Magandang araw sa inyong lahat. I'm Eunice and welcome to Life Essentials. So for today, we will discuss 1st, 2nd, and 3rd John. In the Gospels, there was a time na an expert in the law tested Jesus by asking, "What is the greatest commandment?" Jesus replied that we are to love God and our neighbor. And the book of John reiterates this. Sabi sa 1 John 3 verse 23, "And this is His commandment, that we believe in the name of His Son, Jesus Christ, and love one another, just as He has commanded us." Pero what is love? According to Merriam-Webster, pwede siyang strong affection out of personal ties like sa family. Pwede ring affection felt by lovers. Affection based on admiration. Pwede din gamitin ang love to things that we like. It's common nowadays to say na I love chocolate, I love dogs, I love cats, etc. Ang tanong is, ito ba yung love in God's kingdom? Is this the kind of love when we say love God and our neighbor? Parang positive feeling or affection? Loving something na we like? Nung sinabi ni Jesus sa followers niya na love God and one another, did He mean na basta I like lang natin ang bawat isa? Of course, no. And I think most of us Christians won't think that way. Pero ano nga ba ang love na tinutukoy dito? This is something we should keep in mind as we go through John's epistles. When Jesus knew na malapit na yung time niya, He gave an example of love by washing the feet of His disciples. This love of the kingdom is very different from our culture's definition of love, both in depth and expression. Ultimately, this kind of love is defined by the cross where God demonstrated that He is love. Kasi sobrang undeserving tayo ng love niya. His love characterizes mercy, humility, and sacrifice. The John who wrote these epistles were among Jesus' earliest disciples. Many believe it's John who wrote the gospel because the language and style are identical. With this, imagine the John whom Jesus loved, who had his feet washed by Jesus and was transformed by the love of the kingdom, because he himself experienced this love in Christ. In John's 3 letters, he explains what love was and the effect it should have on our lives as subjects of Jesus Christ and how this sort of love makes all the difference in showing that our Christianity is real and not counterfeit. So let's go first with the background of these short letters. First, let's discuss the apostolic authority. These epistles are technically anonymous, pero there is a strong internal and external evidence that the author is John the Apostle. In 1 John, the author made it a clear claim na he is an apostle from the very beginning, sabi nga sa 1 John 1 verse 1 to 3, "That which was from the beginning, which we have heard, which we have seen with our eyes, which we looked upon and have touched with our hands, concerning the word of life, the life was made manifest, and we have seen it, and testified to it, and proclaimed to you the eternal life, which was the Father, and was made manifest to us, that which we have seen, and heard, we proclaim also to you, so that you too may have fellowship with us, and indeed our fellowship is with the Father, and with His Son, Jesus Christ." John is one of the we who saw, touched, and heard the word of life. And the language is similar to the language of the fourth gospel. If we consider that John wrote the fourth gospel, then we can also consider that he wrote 1 John. Lastly, the earliest church witnesses attribute the 3 epistles to John the Apostle. Next is the date and audience. We don't know when exactly this was written, but reference shows that they were probably written at the end of his life. Almost the same time he wrote the gospel, which was around 90 AD. The second 2 letters are written as they await the personal visit of John the Elder. 2 John was addressed to a church, while 3 John was addressed to a person named Gaius. They are largely concerned with warnings against supporting false teachers and encouragements to showing genuine hospitality to Christian preachers. We will spend more time in the largest chunk, which is the 1 John. So let's go. 1 John can be difficult to understand, especially if di na-consider yung context. Kaya it's important to note of the overarching aim of the letter. Sabi sa 1 John 5 verse 13, I write these things to you who believe in the name of the Son of God, so that you may know that you have eternal life. And this is the confidence that we have toward Him, that if we ask anything according to His will, He hears us. Bakit pa nila kailangan magsulat ni John ng letter to assure those who believe in Christ na may eternal life sila? Why? Kasi may mga kumakalat na false teachings regarding the person and work of Jesus Christ. So itong letter is to oppose those false preachers and then provide categories kung paano nga ba nila ma-assure ang kanilang salvation. Sabi sa chapter 2 verse 22 to 23, who is the liar but he who denies that Jesus is the Christ? This is the Antichrist. He who denies the Father and the Son. No one who denies the Son has the Father. Whoever confesses the Son has the Father also. Say as an overview, the false teachers were claiming to be without sin. They were denying Jesus as the Messiah in human flesh. They were denying Jesus' atoning death. They have no love for Christians and have no concern for holiness. Tapos yung mga followers ni Christ na di nag-aagree sa mga to is tinatawag na di daw totoong Christians ng mga false preachers. So parang nabaligtad. So for 1 John, this will be our approach. Coming from sa mga pangyayaring nabanggit kanina, John wrote from two perspectives. Doctrinally, he writes to refute the false teachers. Then pastorally, John wants to give the Christians ground for assurance that is not limited on verbal, like, just take my word for it, in Christ ka na. But an assurance grounded in solid evidence that people can assess their own lives and see evidences of God's grace. So with those two purposes, we see the beauty of the book of 1 John. Usually, 1 John is difficult to read kasi compared to other books like Letters of Paul na may one train of argument like, you are this, therefore do this, so you'll be this, and so forth. Si John, walang ganun sa letter niya. Instead, John had a number of themes or points where he returns to again and again, weaving them into the tapestry of the book. So somehow, lighter siya in a way kasi more of pastoral approach na parang conversation rather than argument yet to know. So let's go through the outline of the book. The introduction, sabi sa verse 3, that which we have seen and heard, we proclaim also to you, so that you too may have fellowship with us, and indeed our fellowship with the Father and with His Son, Jesus Christ. Here, John introduces himself as an eyewitness of Jesus, proclaiming the message of Jesus so that others would know that fellowship with God and others is centered on a right understanding of Jesus. Next is the first meditation on assurance. Paano ba natin malalaman na tayo ay in Christ? That is, by the fruit in our lives. Sabi sa verses 5 to 7, this is the message we have heard from Him and proclaimed to you, that God is light, and in Him is no darkness at all. If we say we have fellowship with Him while we walk in the darkness, we lie and do not practice the truth. But if we walk in the light as He is in the light, we have fellowship with one another, and the blood of Jesus, His Son, cleanses us from all sin. So we know that we are in Christ when we walk in the light. But John is quick to clarify that walking in the light does not mean we never sin. Sabi nga sa verses 1, chapter 1, verse 10, hanggang chapter 2, verse 1. If we say we have not sinned, we make Him a liar, and His word is not in us. My little children, I am writing these things to you so that you may not sin. But if anyone does sin, we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ the righteous. Then he continued to chapter 2 verse 5, obedience to God's commands is a sign that we are in Christ, specifically loving our brothers in Christ. Having us at chapter 2 verse 9 to 10, whoever says that he is in the light and hates his brother is still in the darkness. Whoever loves his brother abides in the light. So again, one way to know is yung love natin for our brother. Tapos kinlose ni John itong section in a very pastoral way. He identified evidences of grace in his readers to assure them that they are in fact in Christ. Na sila mismo, they meet this test. Sabi nga sa chapter 2 verse 12, I am writing to you, little children, because your sins are forgiven for His name's sake. Minsan, parang super taas ng standard sa sulat na dyan. So, it's a good reminder, yung mga verses na ganito. We can be assured of our salvation because we have trusted in Christ for forgiveness and affirmed that His readers have met this standard. Next is the warning against following the world. Titus chapter 2, verse 15. Do not love the world or the things in the world. If anyone loves the world, the love of the Father is not in him. And then after noon, he goes back to the topic of assurance. Now we know that we are in Christ if we do what is right. Sabi nga sa chapter 3, verse 6. No one who abides in him keeps on sinning. No one who keeps on sinning has either seen him or known him. So being in Christ meant na yung to keep on sinning is not something that we practice anymore. And in order to let loving others, of verse 16, by this we know love, that he laid down his life for us, and we ought to lay down our lives for our brothers. Then aside from obedience and love, John discuss an important assurance, which is the Holy Spirit's presence that confirms our position in Christ. Sabi sa chapter 3, verse 24, whoever keeps his commandments abides in God, and God in him. And by this we know that he abides in us, ano? By the Spirit whom he has given us. So, the Holy Spirit is an important assurance of us being in Christ. Then after itong topic, ulit ang assurance, John gave a strong exhortation toward faith and love. On love, sabi sa chapter 4, verse 10 to 11, and this is love, not that we have loved God, but that He has loved us and sent His Son to be the propitiation for our sins. Beloved, if God so loved us, we also ought to love one another. So, ganun yung basihan. Then on faith, sabi sa chapter 5, verse 10, whoever believes in the Son of God has the testimony in himself. Then after nito, he gave a conclusion about confidence in approaching God. So that is the overview. Now we will examine a few of John's major themes. Sabi sa chapter 3, verse 23 to 24. And this is his commandment, that we believe in the name of his Son, Jesus Christ, and love one another, just as he has commanded us. Whoever keeps his commandments abides in God, and God in him. And by this we know that he abides in us, by the Spirit whom He has given us. In these verses, may tatlong test na binigay si John for us to know whether we are in Christ or not. First is doctrinal, whether you or I believe the right things about Jesus. We'll go through that more later. Next is moral, which is whether you or I obey the commands of God. And the third is social, which is whether you or I love the people of God. So the first is doctrinal. Sabi sa chapter 2, verse 22, who is the liar but he who denies that Jesus is the Christ? This is the Antichrist, he who denies the Father and the Son. Throughout the book, John is countering false teachers na nagde-deny that Jesus is fully God and fully man. The teachers separated out Christ's divine spirit and his fleshly body. So ano naman impact nito sa atin today? You see, without a fully human and fully divine mediator, we cannot have the atoning sacrifice for sins that we need. A sacrifice made an appropriate representative of the human race and one that is infinitely valuable. Believing in the full humanity and full divinity of Christ is of paramount gospel significance. It is also key to knowing who the Holy Spirit is. Sabi nga sa chapter 4, verse 2-3, by this you will know the Spirit of God. Every spirit that confesses that Jesus Christ has come in the flesh is from God. And every spirit that does not confess Jesus is not from God. So important talaga yung tamang belief of it telling kung we are in Christ. Usually concerned tayo sa attacks on Christianity and the gospel by atheists, skeptics, pero First John shows us that the church faces dangers other than the well-known atheists and skeptics. Sabi nga, the real danger is not unbelief, but wrong belief. Not irreligion, but heresy. Not the doubter, but the deceiver. Wrong belief, heresy, and deceivers are what concern John. So John refused the idea that Christ was merely fleshless, impersonal principle that we tap into for higher energy. He also refutes the idea that Jesus was merely a teacher who taught the way of God, who became hungry and tired, and who one day bled to death. We must get the doctrine of Christ's person right, as John presents it, because our salvation hangs on it. Though doctrine alone is not enough. Sabi ni James, even demons believe the right things about Jesus. So the next is the moral test. What is the quality of our obedience? Sabi sa 1 John 3, verse 7 to 10. Little children, let no one deceive you. Whoever practices righteousness is righteous, as he is righteous. Whoever makes a practice of sinning is of the devil, for the devil has been sinning from the beginning. The reason the Son of God appeared was to destroy the works of the devil. No one born of God makes the practice of sinning, for God's seed abides in him, and he cannot keep on sinning because he has been born of God. By this, it is evident who are the children of God and who are the children of the devil. Whoever does not practice righteousness is not of God, nor is the one who does not love his brother. So, sobrang black and white ng teaching, di ba? Pero does it mean if nag-sin, I'm no longer a child of God? Of course not. As I said in 1 John 2 verse 1, if any Christian sins, Jesus speaks to the Father in our defense, yung binasa natin kanina. Remember, in this book, we need to take each part in context, but at the same time, don't let it soften yung sharp points that John is making. Yung mga sharp na contrast na binibigay niya. One way of John stating things in black and white is no sinulat niya, anyone who does not do what is right is not a child of God. That is very convicting as it casts the light of simplicity into our lives as Christians. First John gives us the full context, but in particular verses, pinapakita how simple things are. As quoted from Capitol Hill Baptist Church, your life will display one general pattern or the other, as they have explained it. If anak ka ng Diyos, you will live like him. If child of the devil, then you will live like one. That's all there is. There are no Christians na nabubuhay perfectly like God, and no non-Christians living perfectly like the otherwise. Still, there is a sharp contrast between love of the world and love of God. Light versus dark. Children of God versus children of the devil. So, our lives will display one general pattern or the other. This does not mean na lahat ng nice ay Christian. Maraming nice people na di Christian. Again, moral test is the fruit or proof of the doctrinal test. Lastly, we have the social test. Obeying the moral test also meant loving one another. Actually, this was repeated ng maraming beses sa buong letter, yung loving one another. Sabi nga sa 1 John 4 verse 19 to 21, we love because he first loved us. If anyone says, I love God, and hates his brother, he is a liar. For he does not love his brother, whom he has seen, cannot love the God whom he has not seen. And this commandment we have from him, whoever loves God must also love his brother. So, paano natin nalaman if we love God? Yan ba ay through our doctrinal correctness or sa ating strict obedience? Or pag-feel na feel natin yung pag-sing ng praise and worship songs. John points here that it should not stop with that. Our love for God is demonstrated in our love for people. Jesus identifies with people. But he says our attitude towards Christians is our attitude towards him. Sabi nga sa chapter 3 verse 14, we know that we have passed out of death into life because we love the brothers. Again, there is no in-between option in 1 John. You can believe all the correct doctrine you want, read all the right Christian books, have an outwardly upright life, and yet, if you don't love the people of God, then you are not a Christian. You may say na I love God, I love Jesus, I love learning about Him and following Him, though di ko lang talaga feel yung ibang tao. But when we think back on the verses on chapter 4, John reasons that if I can't love a brother who has been loved by God and is the image of God, how can I love God na di ko nakikita and has created this brother and loves him. John argues from the greater to the lesser. Those who love God love others. So if you're not doing the lesser, there's no way you're doing the greater. Then he challenges us to show our love for others in real practical ways. Sabi nga sa chapter 3, verse 17 to 18, but if anyone has the world's good and sees his brother in need, yet closes his heart against him, how does God's love abide in him? Little children, let us not love in word or talk, but in deed and in truth. So it's not just about belief and morality. Genuine faith results in active love amongst church members for one another. We need to love those who don't look like us nor act as we do. The most honest test of a Christian is whether we love those whom we have disagreed or had difficulty. In summary, if any of these tests, doctrinal, moral, social, are taken apart from others, they become hollow or nawawala yung meaning. These three are connected to one another. Our assurance is not based on some spiritual experience in the distant past. If you are struggling, it's good to check on this test. And we may neither obey nor love perfectly. But ask yourself, a close Christian friend, does my life look different because of who I believe Jesus to be? Am I seeking to obey His word and to love others? I hope that we will be people who need the words of John and live lives that are radically altered by the gospel of Jesus Christ. As an illustration that I remembered, na if nabangga ka ng truck, it's impossible. Sorry, if nabangga yung kotse mo ng truck, it's impossible na hindi siya mayupi. In the same way, if we ourselves have met Christ, it's impossible na hindi tayo mabago. Now moving on to 2 John and 3 John. Key is in 2 John is this: Christians should not support those who are false teachers. Sabi nga sa verses 10 to 11, if anyone comes to you and does not bring this teaching, do not receive him into your house or give him any greeting, for whoever greets him takes part in his wicked works. John tells us here that there is a huge difference between what is appropriate in relating to false teachers who claim to be Christians compared to non-Christians who simply recognize themselves to be non-Christians. Non-Christians, we know that they are non-Christians. We are to show great generosity and hospitality, but we are not to help the person who claims to teach the truth about Jesus, but in fact, tells lies about Jesus. As said in verse 7, for many deceivers have gone out into the world, those who do not confess the coming of Jesus Christ in flesh. Such one is the deceiver and the antichrist. In our increasingly pluralistic religious culture, many consider it charitable to assume that anyone who calls themselves a Christian is in fact one. But this is the dangerous assumption. As 1 John called us to examine ourselves to see if we have the right doctrine, obedience, and love, which characterize genuine salvation. So 2 John says that to the best of our ability, we have the responsibility to ensure that we support in ministry those that are faithful and are teaching the truth about Jesus. Now, this call that John makes, not take the false teacher at your house, is one that we must understand correctly. Sa culture nila, having someone in your home was not only a significant source of support to them, but a sign to the surrounding community that you endorsed what they were doing. For our purposes today, I think we should think of this pattern in those terms. Does that mean you cannot eat with your coworker or invite your brother for Christmas? Of course not. But it does mean that we should not give financially or practically support to those who claim in the name of Christ but actually preach a false gospel. Parang do not be a part of that ministry. And yun yung warning that 2 John gives us. Tapos, if 2 John focuses on why not extend hospitality or support false preachers, 3 John is about why extend hospitality to faithful teachers. We have two characters, namely Gaius and Diotrephes. Sabi sa verse 9 to 11, John says, I have written something to the church, but Diotrephes, who likes to put himself first, does not acknowledge our authority. So if I come, I will bring up what he is doing. talking wicked nonsense against us. And not content with that, he refuses to welcome others and also stops those who want to and puts them out of the church. Beloved, that is Gaius. Do not imitate evil but imitate good. Whoever does good is from God. Whoever does evil has not seen God. So first see Diotrephes. What do we know about him? Is he sympathetic with the false teachers? Has he personally fallen out with John the Elder? Ganun kadami information about him in this short letter. It does say that Diotrephes likes to put himself first. As said in verse 9, Diotrephes makes trouble for the gospel by loving himself first. After commenting on the character of Diotrephes, John says, whoever does good is from God. Whoever does evil has not seen God. Well, John does not go as far as calling Diotrephes as a false teacher in the same mold as those in 1 John, he certainly seems to be pointing to him as an example of what church leaders should not be. Next is Gaius. Sabi nga sa verse 5, beloved, it is faithful thing you do in all your efforts for these brothers, strangers as they are. Gaius was showing hospitality through Christian preachers. Gaius loves the brothers. Diotrephes loves himself. Gaius gives out of his hold for the brethren. Diotrephes wants to make sure things go his way. So if ever may isa sa kanila who understood the right doctrine, obeyed God's commands, and loved other Christians, like what 1 John discussed, Gaius seems to be the one. Then in verses 6 to 8, we read about what Gaius should continue to do. Abidon, you will do well to send them on their journey in a manner worthy of God. For they have gone out for the sake of the name, accepting nothing from the Gentiles. Therefore, we ought to support people like this, that we may be fellow workers for the truth. Who are these men? They seem to be kind of gospel workers, missionaries perhaps, and hospitality towards them is commanded, a pattern we should also follow. Actually, when we host missionary families, give monetary support or other ways to show hospitality, we are not just supporting them. According to this verse, we are actually working together with them. So all the more we should look out for the most strategic gospel ministry going on in the world to support it. In conclusion, how do we distinguish between real and counterfeit Christianity? How do we know what true love is? 1 John gives us biblical reasons to evaluate if we are in Christ. Do they affirm the divinity and humanity of Jesus? Yung buhay ba nila is in God's light? Do they love the body of Christ? In 2 John, we have instruction on what true love is not. It is not supporting and endorsing false teachers who deny Christ. And lastly, in 3 John, we have the real example of what true love is. A man who walked in the light by opening up his home in love to those who preach the truth about Jesus. My prayer is to personally reflect in the contrast of John gave in his first letter. Then take note of the warning in the second letter. And lastly, follow the example of Gaius in the third letter. Sabi nga sa John 13 verse 35, by this all people will know that you are my disciples, if you have love for one another. Thank you and happy weekend.